Pretty blue, dotted brown, flying all around. Shiny thing, broken wing, burying in the ground. All of glint, glitter bright, little flitter in the night. Shiny thing, broken wing, buried in the ground. Here I lay, in bed I stay, with nothing but a frog. Shiny thing, broken wing, buried in the ground. Dotted brown, flying all around, all of glitter bright.
Hey, honey, been thinking of you all day. Hope you don't mind me filming. I just want something of you to remember. I miss you. So much.
Everything all right?
Yeah, just saying hello.
Let me know if you need anything.
Will do. The orphanage. What happened?
Let's give them a hand as they grab their seats. So first things we're going to do is introduce yourself.
Craig Efros, writer-director.
Mel Efros, producer.
Use your mic, Mel.
Mel Efros, producer.
Jami Rudofsky, casting director.
So as we all know, it takes a village and a family to make a film. So you want to acknowledge any cast and crew in the audience?
Yeah, definitely. I want to thank Kanan Howell, our stunt coordinator, Sam Bauer, our editor and sound designer. Some of our actors are here, Sunkrish, Val, and Lindsay, and Polly, our costumer, and Eddie Perez. Thank you guys for doing this.
Nice. So for those who don't know, we screen independent films and share and hear stories from the filmmakers, one, to kind of learn the behind the scenes, but two, also to inspire actors to create their own work. So we're just going to jump right into it. And the first thing we always kind of talk about is story and script. How did it kind of come to be for you?
So I guess originally, you know, like a lot of people, I like reality TV, and sometimes I'll just turn it on. And, you know, I found the ghost shows interesting, but like most, you know, like reality TV, you know, it's faked. You know, it's a lot of it's falsified because you can't have every week have like a ghost thing happen. So, you know, it was interesting to me to think, well, what are they doing behind the scenes? Like, what are they like off camera, and how do they react? I mean, you know, what do they do to keep themselves going? And, you know, at the same time, I thought a lot of them were kind of frat boyish, so it kind of just had this funny vibe to me of these, like, behind the scenes, you know, characters. And then the other part of it for me was I was always interested as a kid in sanitariums. Don't ask me why. No, I thought it was interesting when I saw The Miracle Worker as a kid because it really bothered me. There was Anne Bancroft's character, Annie Sullivan, would always have these weird flashbacks. And as a kid, it was pretty jarring. And it was, you know, it was black and white, and they go blurry. And then when you would see her talk about this. It was just, it was upsetting because she would say, you know, we lived there and we ate rats. And, you know, it was really upsetting as a kid. And I thought, you know, what a terrible thing to have these orphanages. Well, it was really a sanitarium where they would put these poor kids who were ill or invalided. And that was kind of what gave me the impetus to make this.
And then how did it get into script form? How many drafts? Kind of, what was that process like for you?
Script form was tough. I did a first draft and, you know, I felt I was... First draft kind of went really smooth because I don't know, it just seemed to flow out of me, but I probably went through about seven full drafts of just like rewrites. I got some great notes from some people and I just kept plugging away and plugging away. And then to be fair, when you're on set, it's almost like rewriting again between the actors and everybody, and things don't always go as planned, so then you got to try it again. But a lot of my actors were really creative and we had a great cast, and they would come to me and they would say, you know, we have these ideas, can we do this, can we try this? And as long as I didn't feel like it was breaking out of what we were doing, you know, we would go for it, and I think it worked out well.
And then, Mel, is that when you came aboard, when the script was done? How was that kind of conversation between father and son? How did that happen?
Pretty much. I mean, I let Craig work away at it, and then eventually I got involved. And, you know, we'd always wanted to do a film together, he and I. And so I thought this is a perfect opportunity. We pretty much had to raise the money ourselves. Craig had to put the money in. I had to put the money in. We had one silent partner. And so it was
it's a labor of love.
Yeah.
Labor of love. And also, he's my toughest critic. A lot of people think you're just going to give it to family, they're going to go great. No, the first script I ever gave him, he said he hated it. So that was typical. That was typical. But it was good. It makes me work harder.
Did you do the drafts your own, or did you, in that seven-draft process, kind of pass them over to Mel?
No, Mel was obviously, he's usually one of my first people I go to when I finish a script. He's, you know, when you have years of experience, you know, Mel's been doing it for a long time, and you know, I trust his judgment and his opinion, and he's honest. So, you know, if he doesn't like something, he'll tell me. And so he was one of the first people I went to, and then we went to a lot of other people and got their opinions, other writers and people we know, so.
And then what was the kind of turn of phase for you and once kind of financing came to be there, like, okay, we're actually going to make this happen and it's going to give a go versus just kind of a maybe? What was that experience?
I mean,
like?
Yeah, that was tough. I mean, it was really, because he's comfortable in the studio system, and I've worked on a lot of low budgets and things like that, but, you know, and I've done short films and other things, but this was the first time we said, you know, we're going to put our heart into it, we're going to take our money, and we're going to do something for ourselves. And that's a big step. I think it's tough. I commend anybody who wants to make a film.
There are so many pitfalls. I'm sorry.
But I'm not used to the mic.
So used to the studio system. They have a boom usually above me. For anyone that wants to make a film, it's very difficult today. And I think part of the problem is not just financing. There are so many confines today. I mean, if you want to go out and make films today, you have to have insurance. The prop houses, water houses won't give you the money. I won't give you the props or the goods unless you're covered with insurance. If you want to go shoot in the streets of LA, everybody's watching. The city is there, the fire department's there, the police department's there. It isn't like the old days where you go out and sort of sneak around and, you know, just make films. It's much more difficult today. So there's so many confines and controls that for young filmmakers...
Well, and to be fair, there's an easier side too, which is that the technology is cheaper and a little bit easier to get your hands on. So there's kind of a give and take. It's harder in a lot of ways and it's easier in some ways. So, and the hard part is just figuring out what's the best way to do it and try to do it. And as I said before, the best rule is to try to do it as cheap as possible, which is always tough.
And then you made a short film before this feature.
Right.
Did you, is that kind of where you leaned on for your crew and kind of people that you worked with, or how did that kind of process work for you?
So the first person I went to after Mel was Sid, our DP, because we had worked with Sid before on Wanted a long time ago, which is a TV series. And I knew Sid was talented, and he's a really intelligent cameraman with a great eye. And so he was the first person we went to talk to. And he liked the script, and that goes back to the funniest thing, is he read the script, he liked it, and he said to me, you know, this reminds me exactly of Linda Vista, which ended up being our home for the hallway scenes and everything. So he was right on, and it did. It worked great for us. But he was the first one, and before I even worked with Sid, Mel had actually introduced Sid to Chris Strong, who was our gaffer. And Chris is great, and I mean, he's done so many terrific films and shows. And you know, I knew if we got Sid, we'd get Chris, and so they're a great package to come together and work with. And then after that, it was really, you know, and Mel knew Jami, which was a huge plus. Jami was, you know, we couldn't have done anything without her. She was amazing. And Jamie and Mel had worked together on Gilmore Girls. Right. And so Mel said, well, I'm going to call Jamie and bring her over and we'll, you know, start looking at casting. So
you just did my transition for me nicely right there.
Yeah,
so
trying to help segue.
You perfect segue. So Jamie, you get the call from Mel, and is it just like, yes? What was
yes.
it?
Mel
like,
calls me,
again.
I say yes. I've known him for a long time, and we just always had a great working relationship. And when he said, you know, my son and I are working on it, and I'm like, yes. I read the script and I was like, ooh, cool. Cause I've never done, you know, Gilmore Girls was not a horror film per se. comedian over here. So when I read the script, I'm like, ooh, this is fun. This is going to be a fun process. So, and I have to say, this is the first time I've seen the full movie tonight, and it was so much fun, first of all, because I forgot some of the little nuances and things that happened, so I was quite scared at certain places. And I was so happy with the cast and the way they all meshed together and played and had fun, and it brought the lightness to the film that I also loved, so.
Peel back the curtain a little bit. What conversations do casting and directors and producers have before the sessions start? What are you, is it looks that you're specifically looking for, or kind of what the conversations was in?
I mean, I guess when we met Jamie, I won't say the place, but we met her in Los Feliz area, and we basically said...
Mysterious.
Los Feliz. I won't say the restaurant, because I don't want to give them props. No, they were fine. But we met Jamie, and she liked the script, and she said, you know, I think this is funny. I've seen these kind of shows, and I really like this. And so we just started talking about, you know, who could play these parts, and it's really tough because... The way we shot the film, this kind of plays out to our actors and their strengths, is we did long takes. I mean, these were long takes, and we didn't have a lot of time. We had a very tight schedule. So I really needed people who were really strong, you know, in every aspect, because they had to carry some of these scenes for, you know, 5-10 minutes at a time, which was tough. And so Jamie started showing me different people, and we would talk about it, and she showed me a lot of their reels, and, you know, we're doing locations, because we really were rushing around, and Jamie came up with some great people, and, you know, we were just lucky to get a lot of the cast, and they were really terrific.
And then talk about it on the other side, once the auditions happen, what are those conversations? Is it just pure chemistry? Is it like a little tweaking of, well, we go this way or that way? Maybe start with Jamie. What was your kind of perspective on that?
I think it was more thinking about each character and how the actors would play off of each other. And also just knowing their talents. It's like, you know, Craig said, I knew a lot of the actors from before that I cast, and I knew their work, and I knew that they could come to set and totally, you know, own it. And, you know, the other thing that I really appreciated is I think a lot of the actors I got have done other big stuff, and so for them to go, yeah, I'll come work for not a lot of money on something and give their time, and that, you know, I always am so appreciative. I also cast a lot of theater, so when people come out to do theater for no money, I'm like, I'm so grateful. And then getting Lance and Michael T was just awesome. And that's just like people who want to work and like good stuff and thought it was fun, and they're like, yeah, I'll come out for a day or two. And it's always helpful to get guys like that. I mean, Lance, I mean, he showed his ass. I mean, that's awesome. he was like, he had no qualms, you know? I mean, and he was just a fun addition to the film, so.
Nice. And then transitioning from casting, then how many days were shooting? Kind of give us a behind-the-scenes glimpse into that kind of...
Well, I hate to say the actual number, but I'll just tell you it was under 2 weeks, which sounds crazy. But, I mean, that was a very tight schedule.
Fast, yeah.
So there was, and it was tough for us because I was giving my actors credit, but the tough part was we would have to do scenes with visual effects, special effects, stunts, and it would all be animals, and it would all be like one take children. I mean, so it was like a pretty packed schedule of throwing a lot in there and trying to make it all work in a short amount of time.
It's kind of more of a TV schedule than
oh yeah, definitely. Not, I mean, everybody who worked is like, I've never shot a film, and you know, this tight. You know, especially for our big studio guys, are like, I've never done this. But we had such a talented crew and cast that it really was, I wouldn't say effortless, but it was much easier than, you know, I would think it would be in any other way.
did you have any rehearsals beforehand, or you just didn't have time, or didn't
We did. We kind of came up with like an interesting thing, and luckily, you know, because some of our actors are theater actors too, so I got lucky with that. But we did a couple days before we shot of rehearsals with main cast. And then once we kind of got them in there and they were rehearsed a little, then we would start to set up the day. And the first day was tough because, you know, everybody was new and we're all trying to get stuff done. There was a lot going on that day. And it was thanks to Sid and the actors and everybody, we kind of said, well, you know what works is if we let them rehearse it, we rehearse it, and then we go back in and we kind of alter it and tweak it and put it back together. And doing that actually really helped us because, again, we had such long takes that it really worked out well, you know, and it helped.
And this is a chance we also, I love to hear the stories of the behind the scenes. We saw the final product, but what are some maybe scenes that we didn't know the complication that it took to get that shot? Like it stopped raining for 5 minutes or...
Well, the cat's a perfect example. Cat's a perfect example because, you know, we were told, okay, you're going to pay the trainer, the cat's going to come out, it's going to do everything you want, you know, and we're like, oh, great, this is going to be perfect. We'll have the cat, it'll jump around. Anyway, what happened is, so we get there, and originally the cat was supposed to jump out of the cupboard. It was going to be cockroaches on one side and the cat on the other. And cockroaches were a problem too, but that's a different deal. And so the cat guy comes in, and he goes, yeah, I mean, it's a little tight, maybe we could put it on top of the cupboard, or, you know, we'll do this. And he goes, but, you know, I have to be right underneath to get it to jump at me. And I go, well, we can't, because, you know, it's hard to explain. You have to keep telling people, no, we're probably going to see 360. So it's very tough for us to have anybody in the way. So he goes, okay, so we sat there for a second. We said, well, you know, we just have to see the cat. We have to see the cat the first time just so we can, you know, reference it for later when, you know, we do the hit. And so that was tough. The hit was tough. I don't want to give that one away. But I'll say the cockroaches. The cockroaches was interesting, too, because we had real cockroaches, like you have water cockroaches, whatever you want to call them. And then we had the Madagascar babies, which Madagascar babies are little black things, and they're like kind of small. And the big ones, those are those big ones you see in movies that aren't actually, they're not native to LA or America. So we had the big ones, and the regular ones, the American ones, we tried it, and they're too fast. They run away. We probably left a couple there. I feel bad about that. But they ran away, and they got out. And so the next thing was to do the Madagascar babies. Those don't move. They're just sit there. So I'm thinking to myself, oh my God, what are we gonna do? You know, we have ones that don't work, but luckily we had a great post-production visual effects house, which was Magnology, and they're all split up now. They're in different places, but Stephen Lebed and Scott and all the guys that work at Magnology were terrific, and they were able to take that and animate those roaches. And you know, whenever I hear animation of animals or anything, I'm thinking, oh man, it's gonna look bad. But you know, I think it worked out. I think it's believable, and it's fun, and they move kind of quick. And We would go in and I go, oh, you know what, that looks good, but let's have one more go across at the end, you know, just so you have like a little bit more. And it does, it adds like a nice ambiance. And then Val, when Val's grabbing the roach, he grabs a Madagascar baby, and it kind of just works for the scene.
Nice. Sets, where'd you shoot, locations?
So that was another debacle. we said Linda Vista, and Linda Vista did work. We had these, I walked into the hallways and I was like, that's our hallway. That was what I imagined. I don't know if I had dreams about it or nightmares, but it was that round arch with the old, you know, timey lighting fixtures. And I said, that's it. And it had two floors. And that's another quick thing I have to say. So what was tough about that is, in the script, they go up to the third floor, and so they have to run around the stairwell. Well, the stairwell at Linda Vista, which there was only that one big one that kind of worked right down the end of the hall, was open to the world. So we actually had to have them construct and just close that off just to keep it feeling enclosed, which was important. You know, we wanted that kind of claustrophobic, you can't get out feel. But the other bigger problem was a stairwell. Linda Vista doesn't have a straight stairwell like that. And you wouldn't believe it, but thinking we're in LA, you would have 1,000 stairwells, it would be easy to find. It wasn't. I mean, we found one place that had the stairwell. And that's the one you see on film. And they weren't even going to give it to us. And being an independent film was tough, so we had to negotiate and come back. And Mel had a huge fight in a nice way. And they actually turned out being great people, and they were really nice to us. And they finally said, okay, you can shoot here. And that was really like almost a last-minute thing. That was about 3 or 4 days before we wrapped the project. They're like, you can shoot our stairwell.
How did you convince them, Mel? What'd you do?
I cried a lot. And then I looked for a bank somewhere. But what had happened, it was odd because we were on such a tight schedule. We had planned to shoot the staircase maybe 3 or 4 days before the end of the shoot. And
well, we planned the whole time, but we only got it.
But I'm talking, what happened is they rented out, all of a sudden they rented out that whole lower floor that had the staircase to another company for a lot of money. And the owners told the managers, well, we're just going to renege on our contract. And luckily, the managers were able to talk them into letting us to shoot. And we were probably the last people to shoot. Problem was, we needed a staircase that was wide enough to have 3 or 4 people abreast going down.
Well, and our stunt. Yeah. I mean, thanks to Canyon's great stunt with Nick Dash now was our double. Mm-hmm. And I mean, that's when you see the stairwell in person, you're like, wow, that's a huge stairwell to go down. So it was amazing that he did that. And we needed the space so the actors could stand there and he could go by. And I think it worked pretty seamlessly. That was always something we tried to do, was make it look like it almost happened in real time.
We can wrap up the Q&As with nuggets of wisdom or advice for first-timers. I actually want to start with you, Jami. What do you need from a director to do your job well? For anyone that's thinking about directing, what does casting directors need from them?
I think have a pretty clear vision of what the character is and what they're looking for. I have to give a lot of credit to Craig because he put a lot of faith in me and just trusted that I'm like, no, I'm telling you, this person's awesome. Check out their reel, you know, and he was able to see the vision and you know, trust me on that. And that's a big thing. I think a lot of directors, especially first-time directors, are so overly, like, sensitive and don't trust that, you know, we want to help the movie. We don't want to hurt it. So, of course, I'm going to give, you know, suggestions of people I know are great, you know. It's always funny when directors, or we say, like, what are you looking for? And they're like, just great actors. I'm like, oh, okay, I was gonna bring you bad actors. So I gotta change my whole plan there. So I think just really having the vision and also being open to, if sometimes you don't get what you think you're gonna get, that you have to roll with that. You know, sometimes you can't get Brad Pitt for your independent feature. That's a big thing that I think a lot of independent filmmakers have, these grand visions of getting big name actors. And yeah, you know, I think some, depending on relationships and whatever, someone might come and do that, but a lot of the times it's hard. So that's my little pearl.
Nice. Mel, with your wealth of knowledge, which we will need to tap into deeper at a later date, first time producers, what would you be your nugget of wisdom for them?
Well, I think the main thing is evidently trust the script, trust the people you set as directors, trust who you set as actors, and understand that it's a very collaborative effort. I mean, so many times in my career, I've seen times when the producers really didn't trust the directors, didn't trust the actors, and of course, we know the outcome of that approach. So just have a lot of collaboration between all the creative entities.
And then I'm curious for you, directing and writing, can you kind of, for both of those?
As far as directing goes, I'd say trust your instinct and, yes, be collaborative, which is always a positive thing. Trust the people you're working with. And, you know, be open sometimes, too, to what other people have to offer. And then as a writer, I think it's just keep your nose to the grindstone. I mean, writing's, it's probably one of the hardest things because you're putting so much effort and time into it by yourself and hoping other people will like it. And it's a work in progress whenever you write something. So just keep at it.
I think that's a great place to end. Let's give him a hand.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Thank you. Thank you to Dennis.
Yes,
thank you to Dennis Baker and SAG Foundation, Screen Actors Guild Foundation. Thank you for setting this up.
It's a pleasure, guys. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.